So, this is part two of our infantry corporal.
So you can see I've done actually quite a lot of cam. So I finished the pants also, some of the accessory. We could not really do all that on cam, but it's basically just repeating the process that we did on the belt.
Mm-hmm. On the metal, you looks like you used a little bit the same technique as from the Orc Burner Boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the first video in the Academy, definitely check back on that.
We will show you how to get that effect here, that pouch, on as well on the backpack. So
a little larger surface.
A little larger surface, but quite nice with a little texture and some blendings.
We'll do that in part three though, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what will we show in part two?
We will show you how to paint the face. Let me just take off the hat and place it on a pin so it's easier to see.
Okay.
And we'll be back once that is done.
All right.
We'll start with a rather light flesh tone. And in comparison with the cloth, we want the face and the hands to be more opaque.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll start with a rather solid base coat.
And which paint will you be using for that? Or which color?
It's some of the old Talarn flesh from Games Workshop.
Ah, okay.
It's not available anymore, but you could also go for red-beige from Model Color, for example, and add a tiny bit of black, because it's a little bit more desaturated than the Talarn flesh.
Yeah, that was a pretty nice color, the Talarn flesh, wasn't it?
Yeah. Really nice, because it's not so saturated, and it's quite a good tone to start with. Okay, you can see it covers quite a lot. Mm-hmm. You can see hardly any of the grain. I will continue to put the same base color on the ears and the lower part of the neck here.
Mm-hmm. And you go for two passes on this with the paint? Or just one?
I think two should be good.
Yeah.
Maybe I will already add a little bit of the darker brown tone for the low part here, because it should be quite dark in the end.
Yeah. Saves you some work later on.
Yeah. We'll use the same color for the ear. I used a dark red brown. And mix it with the flesh tone. If you mix them, they will turn a bit pinkish, but it's not too bad. I think it works quite nice as a shadow tone.
There's always a lot of people that are asking for recipes for skin, and it's so difficult because skin is so different. If we compare this, for example, to the Kirill Kanaev Legends video, which is coming out next week, probably, week after, he's using completely different shades of more like a reddish skin tone. And he also said that it's almost impossible to give recipes for anything, really.
Yeah, that's really true, especially when it comes to skin. Skin carries so much of information about the personality, where the people live, how much sunlight you have. Giving a recipe for skin is really hard, but I think there's one useful tip, is that you have, like, it's a trick for portrait painters, and it's gives the face a much more natural look when you divide the face in three color zones. So the top part catches most of the sunlight, would get yellow or white highlights.
Mm-hmm.
The middle zone, where you have the more thin skin tissue, is a little bit more red.
Mm-hmm.
And the lower part of the face gets a blue or greenish reflex.
Yeah.
That represents the reflection of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll do that here as well, and you see that it really helps to bring the skin alive.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you see up here it's a little darker than on this side. I didn't intend this just because of the dirty brush. Little shadow here under the nose, just the same shadow tone. A lot of people ask me when I paint faces if I start with the highlights or with the shadows. It really depends on my mood and on what effect I want to be stronger in the end.
Mm-hmm.
I like to have an effect that is clearly visible when I paint, so it's not taking me too long to see what I'm doing. I think in this case I will start with the shadow, but only the very dark shadow under the eye. Here over the eye here.
Mm-hmm.
And then go for highlights. Okay, first of all, just thin layer of the color without any blending. A little bit here.
There are certain areas where you will always do this, and you'll see this later also with the highlights. There are certain areas where you will always apply the highlights when painting a face.
Yeah.
And I think that's much more important than trying to find the right recipe for a color, is where to actually place the shadows and the highlights.
Definitely. I think right now, as we did on the miniature, we will go for basic zenithal light.
Mm-hmm.
But that really helps you to understand where the light would hit the face.
And zenithal light, for those of you who haven't heard this before, means just basically light from above.
So the same brown as a base tone for the lips.
Looks a little weird right now. But...
yeah. And same for the eyes.
You don't want to use black.
Yeah, definitely. Be sure to choose a natural tone for that. I think that's already okay for the first shadows. In the next step, directly highlights. We will use the one brush blending technique, and it's a wet blending technique,
mm-hmm.
Rather than the glazes. As I said, I want the contrast also in the finish of the paint job. Compared to the jacket,
mm-hmm.
I will first mix a light color that is not bright white. You could also go directly for white,
mm-hmm.
But I want the highlight to be a bit warmer. So mix a little bit of yellow ochre in there, some white. First blending here on the nose. A little bit too much. And then just pull it with the lower side of the brush where the color is darker. Pull it down a bit.
Yeah.
Okay, now for some direct white. So another small reflex here on the lower volume of the nose. Okay. A little bit liquid, so I just cleaned the brush and feather it a bit to the sides. It's important to not to put too much of the highlight color into the brush. Otherwise you would end up with just a white face.
Mm.
If some of that looks too strong for you, you could also glaze it with a bit of the mid-tone afterwards again to pull it a little bit more together.
on his cheek, that when he's painting right now, the important part in the pointer to watch out for is that direction in which he puts the highlight. It basically goes a little bit like, in this case, left and under the eye. That's where the highest spot is.
Yeah, like on the top of the not very elaborated cheekbone here.
Yeah.
Because it's a, more like a young face. You don't have too much wrinkles, or it's not a very character face.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you need to be careful with the light. So this here maybe is a little bit strong. Also, an important shadow is this here.
So right now you're skipping a little bit between highlights and
shadows. Yeah, because I want to like finish bit by bit of the face. So here, highlights. And then I just look, okay, before I place the highlight just here next to the shadow, I need the shadow to be there.
Yeah, and this way you can really control the level of contrast you have in the final result. The consistency of the paint right now for all of these steps, what is that?
Well, the color in the back of the brush is a little thinner than the white. Mm-hmm. The white is actually directly out of the pot. It's not diluted before. But I think it's quite nice to see the difference of the two sides.
Yeah.
It looks also a bit stronger on the cam.
Yeah.
All right, for the eyes. We will go for a light flesh tone for to get the white. Never go for a straight white in the eyeball, otherwise it looks really like wide open manga eyes.
Yeah. So maybe we can just walk through the areas on which you put highlights now, like step by step.
Okay, a small highlight point here on the top of the nose. Also another one here to get like the two different volumes of the nose.
Mm-hmm.
Some up here, on the top of the cheekbone.
Yeah.
Here, just next to. To that wrinkle, I don't know how it's called, and one here, a very small one,
back in the corner of the mouth.
Yeah, and one on the chin.
Yeah,
we will also add highlights here on the forehead, and those should be also quite strong. Not so strong up here because we have the shadow of the head, so we don't want this part of the head to be really standing out too much. Mm. Okay. More highlights.
And see how the, well, first of all, he doesn't put the paint everywhere on the forehead, just work on certain areas, and you can all of a sudden see how this volume starts to develop. And I think this is a phase where it's also important because it's a very young phase. It's almost like a woman's phase, very, very soft, that the contrast shouldn't be too strong.
Yeah.
This would be looking really weird.
Especially, it's important when it comes to the shadows. Because the strong shadows, with strong highlight, it can work. But if you add too much shadows, it just looks a bit off.
Mm.
Okay, so a dry end. We'll work on the highlight here.
That was basically a very classic wet and wet move. Put on some base color, a little lighter, and then the white. Clean the brush, and now he's just feathering it out.
These wrinkles here, they're all a bit strong. It's mainly because the base color and the ones I've added white, it's just too far from each other. So
yeah.
I'll mix a glaze with some of the base color and white.
Like a in-between color?
Yeah.
You see how very, very transparent that is?
You see over the white, it's...
Yeah. With glazes, you can pretty much correct almost everything. I mean, some corrections might be taking a while, but like little nuances of something, like reducing contrast or adding a different hue of color, definitely works very well with glazes. Yeah. He looks young, but a little worried.
Yeah, I think he had all reasons to look a little worried.
Yeah, this is 1862, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think
so. So before these guys saw battle between 61 and 62, all of the casualties they had were disease. There was quite a few, actually.
Okay, so more shadows for the worried guy.
Is this also glazed now?
Yep. It makes also a tone that is not the real dark shadow tone,
yeah.
So it's somewhere in between. Okay, right now, a darker color on the brush to get the shadows here into the cheeks. Then just place it, clean the brush, and pull it here up inside of the wrinkles here.
Mm. And again, always moving towards the shadows, very important.
Yeah. Same color on the other side. Yeah, the colors work really nice together. Okay, a little bit of the shadow up under the hat.
Again, Ben pushes everything into the shadows. Then he uses the illegal and not recommended technique of brush licking. And then sweeps the remaining, kind of the borderline of what just painted into the shadows again to make them really smooth.
Okay, some more highlights here to define the parts a bit more. So you can always check with your miniature, and it's important to check in between if the contrast works.
Yeah.
Good together. Yeah, what you see, it works really nice.
Yeah, absolutely.
I will rework some of the contrast and go a bit lighter because we want the face to catch really most of the attention.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I try to use the same color on both sides for the highlights, so I get a similar result.
Yeah. I think the important part here is to know when to stop, right?
Yeah. Right now would be a nice moment to add some of the colored glazes that I've been talking about before. We add the white and the yellow more in the forehead already by doing the highlights. But now we will glaze in some of the colors. You got to be really careful with the red. If you use too much red, he looks either drunk or
sunburned.
Yes, so be careful on that. Bit of red under the nose. And a tiny bit, but you have to be very careful, a tiny bit under the cheek. Clean the brush. And feather to the sides.
Yeah. Oh, cool. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Very subtle.
Also, to increase the effect of the red here, it's nice to add a little bit of pink. So we mix some of the red with some white. For the highlight, but I'll just, before I do that, I'll just go a little bit darker. Clean brush. Mm-hmm.
Reframes the face.
Yeah.
Also yeah. Makes it look a little more fawn in now, like a little narrower face.
And still gives that warm underlying feeling. Okay, some pink. Again, with the pink, be careful. See, the red is here, and we will hit the pink here on top. Quite like that.
Mm-hmm. So what you're going to use now, green or dark sea blue? Or
you could use dark sea blue. We'll use some some black and some, it's called Caspian blue from Scale. And mix that with the base tone of the flesh.
Mm.
So a lot of people think, what's blue? But it really helps. You can also always hide the blue in the beard and the beard shadow.
Mm-hmm.
But the blue looks also good on female faces. You just need to be careful, switch it a little for green. But yeah, it looks always better. So, some blue.
You gonna glaze?
Yep. Okay, place it. Let's feather it.
As you can see, I mean, it was already very thin, and then Ben just placed very little, and then proceeded to kind of spread it over the area he wants to see it on. Now the scale color, even in a glaze, does it give a different surface reflection compared to the other paints? Because right now the paints are a little glossy, like a little semi-glossy.
Yeah.
And the scales are very, very matte. do you see an effect even if you use a glaze like this thin, or?
Yeah, you can. I think, well, it's still a bit wet, but you can see it's a bit more matte on the lower part.
Okay.
I'm just putting some here in the recess next to the hair. Just pull it up here a little. If you compare it to the face before, it's really amazing how that just a tiny bit of red and blue changed the expression of the face quite a lot.
Yeah.
Mm. So I think it would be good to paint the eyes a little bit more. You should actually do that before you do all the blending marks. But the eyes are also pretty little here. So yeah, we'll just do rather simple eyes. Mix some black with some of the Caspian blue. So I want them to look to one side. Not because I want to justify myself, but the eye is also a little bit bigger, this eye here.
Mm.
Mm.
So if you had like a highlight line on
Yeah, there. we try to just correct it with by also adding a tiny highlight next to it to just make things a little bit smaller.
Yeah, so there was a little correction going on left and right, as you saw, but that's basically a little trick that Ben used on the right eye. So from your position in the left eye, he got a little highlight line under the eye, which makes it appear to be a little smaller, catches a little more light, and almost looks good.
Yeah, I think should be okay for now. Do a stronger highlight here. It's still missing some reflex lines on the lips. I'm loading the brush with some of the dark brown, some white to the tip, and I just pull lines, like vertical lines like that. A little dark wash here. You just want some very subtle vertical lines to get a little bit of structure in the lips.
Mm. I guess the important thing here was that you used a pretty light color to put the lines down, and then you kind of went over it again, glazed over it again with the base color.
Yeah.
Reduce the contrast again.
Yeah, also to have the white reflex shining through the thin red brown glaze.
Yeah.
So with the red brown again, just some framework towards the sides. Yeah, I'm quite happy. I think I will just put a base color on the hair and maybe the color, and we'll be back once that is done and can show you how to put tiny bits of highlights on the hair.
Okay, great.
So you can see I've just gave the hairs one base color and framed the head a little towards the side, the dark brown earrings. Mm.
And you also put the head on there to do what?
Yeah, I just put the head on the figure to just check back if the contrasts still work and the figure looks good in total.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm quite happy so far.
Yeah.
Looks really good. The head pops out in a nice way. I think once we'll add some highlights here on the hair, will even be stronger because it's more like fading in with the model.
Mm-hmm.
We will also need to put some highlights here on that area because it's just way too dark. Okay, so let me take off the hat and we'll continue to work on the small highlights and the hair.
Okay, cool.
So painting the highlights here, it will be okay to do the highlights with our base color that we started the flash with.
Mm-hmm.
It will still stand out quite a bit. I will try to just not blend the whole thing, but just add tiny lines that represent wrinkles on the neck. That will be a little too strong, especially when you compare it to the highlight here.
Yeah.
Okay, might look a bit strong. Too big, but we'll glaze over that with the base color. For the hair, I decided to go for some orange brown mixed orange with black. So you can see on the palette, there's some quite bright orange, some black here. I'll add a little bit of white for the highlight, and some of that yellow.
So we're picking out everything that kind of faces light right now, or how do you place the highlights?
Yeah, everything that is raised a bit would catch the light a little bit more.
Mm.
Try to just place tiny bits of light, lighter color here and there. All right.
So that almost concludes it for the face, doesn't it?
Yeah. I think minor parts like the color and the head needs to be painted. I think I won't do anything really special on the head. I will use some of the grain, so we will work. We'll be working somewhere in between the glazing technique and some wet and wet highlights.
Okay. Good. We'll do this in the next chapter.
The head should look like it's pretty worn and not new from the shop. So we'll try to increase the rough grain of the foundation
mm-hmm.
before we start with glazing it.
Okay.
So mix some black here from the side with a bit of white to get a dark grain. And now I try to just dab over the surface to create some like scratches and dots. Try to keep them random from size and direction.
Mm.
Yeah, just try to not to make them too big. I just have some white on the tip of the brush, and I try to highlight the lower side of each of the little, not each, but quite a few major ones, the one I like.
Yeah.
Try to pick them out a bit.
That's basically the very classical highlighting of scratches, what you're doing right now.
Yeah.
But this part is actually very interesting because that's, I wouldn't want to say the latest trend, but it's definitely a trend in miniature painting, especially in competitive miniature painting, is to deal with textures of materials.
Yep.
And in most instances, like we've already shown on leather, for example, the textures are something that you kind of draw first and then you paint over it so that it kind of still comes through. And it's really cool what you can achieve with that.
Yep.
No, it's actually interesting how you can apply these techniques, and I mean just not having to worry about a perfect blending anymore,
yeah.
Whether it's wet and wet or with glazes or whatever, and just create blendings in a very different way with textures. It's just something that I had basically not seen before like that, and I can't wait to try it for myself at some point.
We'll go for some black hat now. We will use almost black brown, so I'll mix some of the orange with black, maybe even a tiny bit of the blue. And now the glazing part, or it's feathering, I just place it. Pull it in the recess.
The distance here is somewhere between the glaze and the layer paint. You see it's definitely not extremely thin, but you also see how the material still shines through. And I'm sure you'll be applying a couple of layers of this, right?
Yeah, we have to see layer after layer how it turns out, and if we need more or even re-emphasize the texture.
Mm.
The base coat was darker, it's already actually quite nice from the first look, but we need to rework here.
Yeah, but that head has seen some action. It's been dropped, tread on, fallen upon.
Yeah, maybe he's not the first one wearing the head. I will do the small elements quickly off cam,
mm-hmm.
and then we're back for just retouching the final highlights to make it all match.
Okay. Okay, now you irrevocably attached his head to his torso.
Yeah, and also finished off the color.
Yeah.
The color with nice little beige. And yeah, I also added the tiny color splashes for the emblems here and the ribbon.
Yeah. So we have the Hardy hat, which was regulation outfit. But if somebody is like a real history buff, he might say, well, this is historically not correct. Because this is the blue, what was it called, the rim, signifies infantry unit. But the infantry units would have all of the brim of the hat on the left side pinned up and not on the right side like on this one here. But that's not necessarily true because we saw that there was some heads like this, actually exactly the same. So they did exist in the field. It was against regulations, but really nobody cared.
Yeah, I guess they had bigger problems than which side of their head was.
Yeah. Actually, it's kind of funny. The guy the head was named after, he was a commandant at West Point. And when the South seceded, he left West Point and became, I think, Lieutenant General in the Southern Army, Confederate Army. And it's kind of interesting that the head, though, stayed with the North mostly. It was also worn by the South, but most people hated it. It was very heavy and worn, so they replaced it with something else. Not so, of course, the Iron Brigade. They didn't care.
They're like the tough guys.
Yeah.
So what I'm doing right now is just retouching these highlights here. You can see the foundation shines through quite a bit. Maybe it's because if you touch the head, it gets a little greasy and the glazes won't stick. I'm mixing a bit heavier color and just dotting it in.
I really like how it kind of sticks out and
draws
attention.
I also really like the different finishes between, if you see the coat down here, mm-hmm. It's really more woolen, the face is more like soft and more reflective.
Yeah.
All right, I think that should be good for the face.
Okay, and then in the next part we'll do the backpack
mm-hmm.
and like little...
Yeah, little bits
areas we seem to do.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thanks for watching.
Yep.